So, hi everyone. Welcome to the second session. Here, Omri Shmueli from Tel Aviv University is going to talk about his joint book with Nir Butansky on post-quantum zero knowledge in constant amounts. This book is going to be published in Stock 2020, right? And if anyone has a question, then you can either raise your hand, but I think it's better just to try to speak and hope that the speaker will hear you. Okay, you're welcome.
Thank you, Benny. So today I would like to talk about this work, Post-Quantum Zero Knowledge in Constant Round, which is a joint work with Nir Butansky. And our starting point is going to be zero knowledge proofs, which really needs no introduction, but still let me remind you what it is. So our setting is that we have an NP language L, we have an instance in the language X, we have a prover, we have a verifier. The prover wants to prove to the verifier that X is in the language. And we have the completeness that promises that if the instance in the language and both parties are ran honestly, then the verifier is indeed going to accept. If the instance is not in the language, that even if the prover is malicious and tries to trick the verifier, the honest verifier is still going to reject. And the zero knowledge asserts that a malicious verifier learns nothing from the interaction with the honest prover, which formally means that we have an efficient simulator such that for every efficient classical algorithm, a malicious verifier, the output of the verifier at the end of the interaction is going to be simulatable. It's going to be computationally indistinguishable from the output of the simulator that obtains only access to the verifier and the instance, of course, not interacting with the prover. Okay, in this talk, we are going to focus more specifically on zero knowledge against quantum attacks. And formally, what do I mean by that? The protocols that we run as honest parties are still going to be classical protocols. The security, however, is going to hold against efficient quantum adversaries. So on the soundness side, we have soundness against efficient quantum provers, and zero knowledge, like before, just against quantum verifiers, which means we have an efficient quantum simulator, such that for every efficient quantum verifier, the now quantum inner state, output state of the verifier at the end of the interaction is going to be computationally indistinguishable from the output of the simulator. Okay. So in terms of what we know so far on round complexity, so we have, of course, the first result of Goldreich, Micali, and Dickerson showing that we have a polynomial round classical zero knowledge for all of NP. We then have the result of Goldreich and Kahan, showing classical zero knowledge in constant rounds. And later we have the result of John Watrous showing post-quantum zero knowledge in polynomial many rounds. But one thing that we don't have yet is quantum zero knowledge in constant rounds. And this is going to be the result that we are going to see today. So assuming a quantum FHE, which is fully holomorphic encryption, where you can encrypt, where you can evaluate quantum circuits, and the quantum hardness of LWE, we have a constant round quantum zero knowledge argument for NP. We also have an in constant round quantumly extractable classical commitment. And as a corollary of these two theorems, combining this with the previous work on zero knowledge for QMA, we also have a constant round quantum zero knowledge quantum arguments where the interaction is quantum for QMA. But today we're going to focus only on the NP result, which really is the interesting part. Okay, so next we're going to see the challenges in quantum simulation and then our techniques. So let's see. Okay, so let's just recall for a moment how to even construct a classical zero knowledge in constant round. This is the protocol of Goldreich and Kahan from the 90s.
Sorry, Omri, it's Alon Rosen. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
Two questions about the previous slide or the slide before.
Mm-hmm. This?
Yes. So first of all, doesn't quantum FHE follow from quantum LWE?
If you add the circular security assumption.
Okay, and the second question, So you construct an argument. So Goldreich Kahn is a proof.
Right.
And the constant round argument is a different paper, right?
You mean classical constant round arguments for
entropy? Yes.
Yeah, it's a different paper. Now, now, as an example of why quantum simulation is hard, I'm going to, just for this beginning, focus on Goldreich Kahn.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Okay, so let's go back to here. So let's see the protocol. It starts like this. The verifier samples a challenge. This is a polynomial length random string. It's going to commit to the challenge and send to the prover. The prover is going to send a commitment, which we denote by alpha. Intuitively, it doesn't really matter what's inside the commitment. Intuitively, this is information that contains the proof. It's not exactly the proof, but it contains a proof showing that X is in the language. And then the verifier decommits to the challenge. And then the prover partially opens the commitment. It shows some part of the proof so that the verifier sees that the challenge, the random challenge that is sent, is satisfied. And then if it is indeed satisfied, it accepts. Okay. And one thing, one small comment about soundness of this protocol is that because the commitment that the verifier sent at the beginning is going to hide this random challenge, then the prover really has to send an alpha, a commitment that really contains a real proof. This is on the soundness side, which we're not going to focus on. Okay, so let's see how to prove that this protocol that we've seen here is a zero knowledge. We need to construct a simulator. And the main point of the simulator is that if the challenge, this random challenge is known before sending alpha, then the simulator can convince the verifier and successfully simulate. So let's see how the simulator is going to obtain this challenge. It's going to execute the verifier's first message. Recall that the verifier is an adversarial machine, adversarial interactive machine. So it outputs an inner state on the side, and also, of course, the commitment. And now, and this is something that we implicitly do in the classical setting without even thinking about. The simulator is going to copy, take a snapshot of the inner state of the verifier at this step. Now it's going to send a commitment to some junk, say zero, and all of the purpose of this commitment is to for the verifier to answer with the challenge. We know that the verifier decommits to the challenge after the commitment of the prover side. And the point is that we took a snapshot of this inner state S, and now we can rewind and go back to before sending the commitment alpha. But now we know the challenge. So after rewinding, the simulator is going to send a new commitment, alpha sub chal, which is going to satisfy this random challenge. And the verifier have to open the commitment to the same challenge because of the binding of the commitment at the beginning, and the simulator succeeds. Okay. And again, the main point to take out of all of this is that the simulator was successful because it could take a snapshot of the inner state of the verifier. This is important. Okay, so now naturally in our setting today, we're going to ask, is the protocol that we've just seen is secure against quantum attacks? And the answer is that we don't know. And we do know that the previous simulation strategy that we just seen is going to fail. Let's see why. Okay, first, before we see why, we're going to go over the absolutely minimal preliminaries in terms of quantum information to understand why this simulator fails. So quantum state, we're going to informally think about it as an n particles inside the black box. We don't know the state of these n particles because this is a black box. And we can perform an action called measurement, where we get information on the bot inside, but when we do this action, we disturb the state inside this black box, and it's not the same state as before. So we get information, we lose information. That's the trade-off in this setting of quantum information. The second thing is that the no-cloning theorem says that if we have this general quantum state, again, this black box register that we cannot look inside, this is an information theoretical statement. No matter how long do we execute, we cannot output two copies of a quantum state of this black box register. And the third and last one is that general quantum computations, they include measurements, and as we said, measurements destroy information and are irreversible, and they change the quantum state we are computing on. Okay, so let's see how these three things are going to disturb us. Let's see the same simulation strategy as before. The simulator is going to execute the verifier's first message, but now it cannot take this snapshot because the verifier's inner state is quantum. And it can maybe try to go forward, sending this commitment to junk, and the verifier is going to answer with the challenge, and that might look good because the simulator now has the challenge, but the point is that the verifier circuit is a general quantum computation. As we said, it contains measurements, and now we have this new state psi 2, and we cannot really rewind. Any questions so far? Okay, great.
I have a question.
If that, yes.
So the only challenge is the rewinding. If I like it seems like any non-rewinding straight line simulator would work.
So this is a great question, and the answer is no, because it's not that the rewinding, the specific strategy of rewinding that is the problem, is the fact that we copy, we clone the state of the verifier. And in fact, all other techniques known that even don't use rewinding, I'm going to get to it in a second, they might not use rewinding per se, but they do clone the state of the verifier. And this is, again, these are things that copying in the classical setting are things that we usually don't think about. They are implicit, but they do clone the state of the verifier, bottom line, yes. Okay. So one quick thing about many round post-quantum zero knowledge is that we know that we use rewinding also in the many round setting. For example, the GMW protocol repeated polynomial many times. We use rewinding in the simulation. But the point is, this is the result of John Watrous, which is called the main technical lemma called the quantum rewinding lemma. And it takes advantage of the challenge string being short. And we know that, as I said, in protocols like GMW, the challenge string can be short as long as it at most polynomially, logarithmically many bits, this is going to be okay. And this protocol is zero knowledge DMW, and repeating it sequentially a polynomial number of times is going to yield a negligible soundness error. And this is how we get post-quantum many round zero knowledge protocols through this, the combination of the quantum rewinding lemma and known protocols like GMW. And this is relates to the question Iftach asked. So there are the traditional simulators like we just seen that are based entirely on rewinding. And the point is that they clone. This is in bold, this is what disturbs us, the cloning, not the rewinding. And we can ask, there are non-black box techniques, there are more sophisticated simulators that actually don't rewind. And are they helpful? I mean, looking at protocols that have non-black box simulator, are they quantum zero knowledge? And the answer is that no, because they do one of two things. They either clone without rewinding, or they use tools that are just not known for quantum computations, like universal arguments. And the question we are asking today is, can we use the circuit of the verifier, that means doing non-black box simulation, to simulate without cloning at all? Not only without rewinding, but without cloning. So let's see. Okay, so let's isolate really the interesting case in all of this. So the only reason we rewinded in the GK96 simulation is to extract this secret challenge of the verifier. So let's construct a commitment scheme, an interactive commitment scheme, where we can extract from quantum circuits, quantumly extractable classical commitments. What exactly do I mean by this? This is a classical protocol in constant number of rounds. We have the receiver and the sender interacting to generate a commitment. You can, without the loss of generality, think of the commitment as the entire transcript. We have a binding, perfect binding. We have a computational hiding against quantum machines. And in terms of extractability, consider the following process. This is a process of interaction between the honest receiver and the malicious quantum sender. They interact, they generate a transcript, they generate a commitment. At the end of interaction, the sender outputs for itself on the side the inner private quantum state. And we also know that the commitment is perfectly binding. This CMT, the commitment fixes, information theoretically fixes a message inside the commitment. And we're going to ask that there is some quantum extractor, efficient quantum extractor, such that for every efficient quantum sender, it's going to simulate all of these three elements. The commitment, what's inside the commitment, and the inner state of the sender at the end of interaction. So this is what we're aiming to construct. And why is it useful for zero knowledge? Of course, just to close this part, we're not going to use the commitment from the GK96 protocol. We're going to swap it with an interactive constant round quantumly extractable commitment where the verifier executes the sender, and this will give us a zero knowledge. So for now, from now on, we're going to concentrate only on these extractable commitments. We're going to have only a sender and a receiver. We can forget about this prover and verifier setting. Okay, so let's see it. But before we see it, let's see the tools. So the first tool is going to be quantum fully homomorphic encryption, which is really fully homomorphic encryption where you can evaluate quantum circuits. It was constructed first by Mahadev in Fox, and then improved by Brakersky. And we're also going to, one more tool that we're going to use is compute and compare obfuscation, constructed by Wicks, Sirdelix, Goyal, Capola, Waters, and Vusirikala. And in order to define what is a CC obfuscation, we first defined a CC circuit. So what is a CC circuit? This is a program defined by a function F, a target U, and a reward Z. And given an input X, it's going to check if the input hits the target. It means that if F of X equals the target U, and if this is indeed the case, it's going to output the reward, and if not, it's going to output null. So this is a CC circuit, and we're going to use an obfuscation scheme for CC circuits. So the obfuscator takes what defines the circuit, F, U, and Z. It outputs an obfuscated circuit, CC tilde, and the correctness promises that this circuit is going to be going to preserve the functionality of the original circuit. And the security says that if the target is maximal entropy, if it's chosen at random, then this obfuscated circuit, CC tilde, is going to completely hide, computationally hide, of course, F, U, and Z. Okay, so these are the two tools that we're using for now. Question? No, okay. And one more thing before we see the first step of the construction is that we're going to simplify our setting with thinking about the adversaries as what we call explainable. This is a notion from Bitansky, Kurana, Panette, 19. So what does it mean? So messages can always be explained. Formally, there is some input to the honest party. If we're now, for example, thinking of the malicious sender and saying this is a malicious explainable sender, then for every message, for all the messages that the sender sends during the interaction, they can be explained. There is some input to the honest sender is going to be consistent with the protocol, but of course, finding this input to the honest party might be hard. And one more thing is that they can abort. So they are explainable until they abort. And the justification for this simplification is that this is really the hard part. It captures the essence of the problem, and formally it can be compiled. There is a compiler constructed by Bitansky, Kurana, and Panette showing how to preserve the round and still going from explainable to malicious. Okay. So now we're going
Omri?
To
Omri?
Yes.
Is it the same notion as the defense in the context of OT or secure computation?
I'm actually not aware of this notion, so I cannot.
Okay. Defense is like semi-malicious. Defense is a different name. You know what is semi-malicious, Omri.
I don't know what semi-malicious. Everyone defines it differently. So you just swapped one terminology by another, but it's not the same as defense in the sense of the Iftach's paper and Yuval et al. No, it's not the same thing. Okay. Yes? No?
So Neil's saying it's not the same thing.
Okay, good.
Yeah. Okay.
In a nutshell, the randomness is not explicit. So defensible means that randomness could be arbitrarily distributed, but it's still explicit. Like in semi-honest, you have access, basically you get free extraction. Here it's implicit. It's an information theoretic guarantee.
So it does mean that it's inside the support, right? It's consistent.
Basically. Exactly.
That's all, it's consistent. Okay.
A question, hi, Tzvan. It's the compare compute, is it classical standard or guess quantum, and what would mean if it's quantum?
It's a classical primitive. The security guarantees is against the quantum adversaries, but the CC circuit is classical.
Okay, I'm trying to parse what would security against quantum mean here. It's a black, you know, VBB obfuscation, right? So
it's a VBB obfuscation of a restricted class of circuits, yes.
So for any quantum adversary, there is a quantum simulator. I guess it would be the same questions here as before, right? For every quantum adversary, the quantum simulator that has Oracle access to the function?
No. This is not, the simulator is classical. It's the simulated view is going to be computationally indistinguishable for quantum adversaries.
But
CC obfuscation, the simulator is actually oblivious. It doesn't use the adversary at all. It just samples from a fixed distribution. So it's basically an indistinguishability base.
Because it's a distribution and not worst case.
Exactly. Exactly.
So you know, otherwise I would have been confused. Okay. Okay.
Okay. So let's keep going. Okay. Let's see the first try. And this first try is inspired by ideas by. Originated by a chain of works on FHE and fully FHE and non-black box extraction techniques. Okay, so let's see. We have the honest receiver and sender, and the first thing that the sender is going to do is to sample two random strings, S and T. It's going to sample keys for the fully morphic encryption. It's going to encrypt T. And one more thing, it's going to obfuscate the following circuit, the circuit that checks if something decrypts to S, and if it decrypts to S, it outputs the reward, and the reward is going to be the message that we want to extract, and also the secret key of the fully morphic encryption. We will see later why we want the secret key. The most simple way to think about it is just that this obfuscated circuit, CC tilde, it gives you the reward for an encryption of S. This is essentially what you want. Encryption of S, you win. Okay, and then it sends the public key, the encryption of T, and the circuit CC tilde. The receiver is going to output some arbitrary guess for the T that under the encryption. It's going to send a T, T prime, and the sender is going to send back S if this guess T prime is the correct one, if it equals to T. So let's just make sure that this is a commitment scheme. It is binding because the CC circuit fixes the message M, so it's perfectly binding. Let's see why it's hiding. So intuitively, there are two ways to break the, there is one way to break the hiding, which is to find M, and there are two ways to get M. One way is to take this circuit CC tilde and try to look inside, but by the security of the CC obfuscation, it hides the reward. And the second thing is that The second way to get the reward is to lawfully use this circuit CC tilde by giving it an encryption of S. And how do we get an encryption of S? We first need to get a S. And how do we get S? We guess the correct T, and to guess the correct T, we essentially need to break the FHE. So we cannot do either. So we have hiding. What about extraction, which is the interesting part? So we have the extractor, and we have a quantum sender, and the extractor is going to execute the first message of the sender. Now we have a quantum state on the side, and the goal of the extractor is to get an encryption of S, right? This is what, now given this program CC tilde, we know that CC tilde give you the reward, which is the message that we want to extract, if we give it an encryption of S. So how can we get encryption of S? The first observation is that under the encryption, the extractor have T. Not sure why is it helpful, but let's let it hold the T under the encryption. And the second observation is that the sender, we know that the circuit of the sender, it returns S for T. So this actually gives us a way of obtaining an encryption of S. Let's see. We can get an encryption of S using the circuit of the sender in a non-black box way. So now we encrypt the quantum inner state of the sender. And under the encryption, we have T, and we also have the inner state of the sender. And the point is that what we're seeing under the encryption in orange is a valid input to the sender, right? The malicious sender computes on its inner quantum state on one side, on a guess from the extractor on the other side. And we can homomorphically evaluate the sender circuit. This is the step where we use the circuit of the sender to get a response. And we know that this response is going to be S, because the sender returns us S for T. And we got an encryption of S, right? So we're going to take this encryption of S, insert it to this CC tilde, and CC tilde is going to reward us with the message to extract M and the secret key SK. And this is the point where we see why we also need SK, because look at this picture, we still have the inner state of the sender under the encryption. So we're going to use this SK to release it. And now we have in red, we have the extracted message, we have the simulated quantum state of the sender at the end of the interaction, and it seems that the extractor simulated successfully.
Omri?
Yes.
Can you do it again?
Yes, of course. Let's do it again.
Okay.
So we're here, the extractor have an encryption of T. And we know that the sender gives you back an encryption, it gives you back S if you give it T, okay? So let's give the sender the input that it wants. The input that it wants is an inner state that it always computes on the side, and a guess from the extractor. And now in this like world we're seeing in orange, this is an input to the sender. At this point, the extractor is going to run the response of the sender under the encryption. It's going to homomorphically evaluate the circuit of the sender with these two inputs and T and the inner state psi one to get a new inner state psi two and a response which we know is S. The point is...
Why is it not an attack on soundness? I mean,
we will talk about it later. We will talk about it later. Okay, it's not an attack on soundness, because the soundness follows from the hiding, right? And we know that the commitment is hiding. Hiding is not the problem. We don't have a problem with soundness yet, actually. I take back what I say. We don't have a problem with soundness in this form of the protocol. And the answer and the reason is that you can perform this attack on the soundness only because you have the circuit of the sender. This is not something that the prover executing a malicious receiver can do, if it makes sense.
Because he doesn't know M, he doesn't know the commitment value. He know the circuit, but he doesn't know the input, right? mean, why cannot?
No.
If it's on the sender, everyone knows the circuit of the sender, right?
No, but you think of this. So the extractor also have the inner state of the sender, inner state of the malicious sender. If you think about the honest sender, this inner state of the honest sender is the randomness. Okay. So the receiver, it doesn't have access, of course, to the randomness.
Okay, I see.
Yes. Okay. Okay, great. So we said that we got the extracted message and we got the inner quantum state now unlocked from the encryption. And are we done? But, and the question is, no, we're not done. And the reason is that the view of the malicious sender in this simulated interaction is very distinguishable from the real view, right? Because let's see what's going on here. In the interaction with the honest receiver, the receiver almost never guesses the correct T, and here in the simulated interaction, miraculously, the extractor always guesses the correct T, right? Recall that under this orange encryption, the sender sees what's happening. It sees that the other side is always sending T, and this is very distinguishable from the real interaction with the honest receiver. And this is a problem, but let's try to fix it. We shouldn't let the sender know what we're sending, and we can do this with two layers of homomorphic encryption. Let's see how this is going to look. For this second layer of homomorphic encryption, we're going to use a circuit private FHE, classical FHE. By the way, this FHE doesn't need to be able to evaluate quantum circuits. So this is really FHE, as I said, with circuit privacy. And circuit privacy says that this ciphertext CT, which encrypts X, if you're going to evaluate the ciphertext with the circuit C, then the evaluated ciphertext CT prime is going to reveal nothing on the circuit C, but the result C of X. Essentially, the evaluated ciphertext hides the information of the circuit C. And we're going to call this circuit private FHE SFE, because we can use circuit private FHE as a one round secure function evaluation. Okay. So this is the second thread of the protocol. As before, we're sending these three parts, and this time the receiver is not going to send its guess out in the open. It's going to send it under SFE encryption, under homomorphic encryption. And the sender is going to respond not with the S out in the open, it's going to evaluate, homomorphically evaluate the circuit that returns S for T. This is the only change. And let's see how we extract. So this part before we could continue to homomorphic evaluation of the sender, but this is not an input to the sender. The sender now awaits an SFE encryption of T. So we're going to give in it SFE encryption of T. We're going to have an encryption under the encryption. We're going to homomorphically encrypt with the SFE encryption circuit T. And what we're seeing here is a valid input to the sender, right? We have an SFE encryption of T. We have its inner quantum state on the other side, and we can now homomorphically evaluate it to get our reward back. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to homomorphically evaluate the sender. The sender is going to, under the encryption, do a homomorphic evaluation of S, and we're going to have an encryption of S. But we need an FHE encryption of S, not an FHE of SFE encryption of S. But this is not really a problem. We can peel this inner layer of SFE under the encryption using another homomorphic evaluation of the SFE decryption circuit. And again, we know what now we see that if we have an SFHE encryption of S, we can give it to the program CC tilde and successfully extract. Okay, so this should be good. And we just seen the scheme is indeed extractable. The scheme is binding, but is it hiding? And the answer is that it's not hiding. Let's see exactly why. The problem is malleability. This approach of two-layer homomorphism is inherently malleable, actually. And the attack is pretty easy. So let's see what a malicious receiver now seeking to find out what is the hidden message the sender commits, what it can do. So the sender is going to send the first message. The receiver is going to take the encryption of T and turn an FHE encryption of T into an SFE encryption of T. Again, the security guarantees of both FHE and SFE, none of them guarantee that a malicious efficient sender cannot do this transformation. Now, CT prime is an SFE encryption of T. It's going to send an SFE encryption of T to the honest sender. And we know that the honest sender homomorphically evaluates and trades under the SFE encryption T for S, and it's going to send an SFE encryption of S. And the final step of this attack is that the receiver is going to take the SFE encryption of S and turn it back into an FHE encryption of S. And we know that whoever has a FHE encryption of S wins because it extracts the hidden message from the program CCTIL. So this is an attack. And what we've seen so far is not hiding. This is not a good commit. But there is a very important point to this attack is that the malicious receiver does not actually know what it's computing on. It turns one FHE ciphertext to one SFE ciphertext, but it doesn't know T. It doesn't know how to open this SFE ciphertext that it sends. And usually this kind of problem in classical protocols, we solve by extraction. If the malicious receiver can give an extractable commitment to the SFE T, to the SFE key of its encryption, then we can show that if it sends an SFE encryption of T, then it necessarily breaks the hiding of the FHE. But it seems like we're back to square one, right? Because we're trying to construct an extractable commitment, but not really. That's the point, because hiding security reductions are existential. This might sound obvious, but what I mean by that is that what we should prove is that if there exists an adversary that breaks the hiding of the scheme, then there exists an adversary that breaks the, say, security of the FHE. We don't have to efficiently compute this adversary that breaks the FHE from the adversary that breaks the hiding. And the other thing is that the receiver SFE key is independent of the messages in the protocol. How can it help us? The receiver can give a regular non-interactive commitment at the very beginning of the protocol of the SFE key, which we know is independent, so it can be sent as the first protocol message. And one good thing about the first protocol messages is that they are extractable by non-uniform reductions. Let's see formally what I mean by that. Let's think of a malicious receiver trying to break the hiding of the scheme. And it's going to send this commitment to the SFE key. And we can assume without the loss of generality that this is always the same commitment with the same key inside. And the reason is that we can, very simple averaging argument, say that it chooses the best message, the best first message to cheat with. And once this message is fixed, we can prove that there exists another receiver attacker, which we call the REC tilde, that is going to be completely identical to the receiver, the original receiver, but it's going to have as classical non-uniform advice, this SFE key that is always the same. And we can prove that if this original receiver breaks the hiding of the commitment, that this a modified receiver, REC tilde, will necessarily break the security of the FHE. Note that this is a non-uniform reduction, of course. So we don't efficiently compute REC tilde from REC. And this solves our problem. And one more very last thing that I completely hid under the rug in the simulation parts. So I assume that the sender was very, very generous with me. So every time I prepared under the encryption, an input for the sender. The input again consists of an SF encryption of T and the inner quantum state of the sender. And then I said, well, I'm going to evaluate it and it's going to send me back S, but we know that explainable adversaries can abort. And in this case, as we see, the sender just decides to abort. And usually if the adversary is abort, this is not such a bad thing, but the problem here is that we used the returned S in order to unlock this inner state side two. Right, we use the encryption of S to get the reward. The reward was M and the secret key of the FHE SK, and we use this SK to unlock this inner quantum state side two. But now that it seems we're stuck, right? We have an encrypted state, and we don't have how to open it. We cannot complete the simulation. Very, very roughly, the solution to this is that the extractor is going to guess if the simulator is going to, whether it's going to abort or not going to abort. And we know that if we already seen that if the sender if the sender does not abort and it lawfully returns S, then we can successfully simulate. But another thing is that if we knew that the sender was going to abort on us, we wouldn't encrypt its inner quantum state in the first place. We would do anything out in the open without doing a non-black box extraction. And just instead of trying to send a T under the encryption, an SF encryption of T under the encryption, we would simply send out in the open an SF encryption of zero subjunct. And then the sender is going to abort and we're going to say, oh, well, you aborted, but we already have your inner state. And this choice of the sender, whether it's going to abort or not, is going to be independent of the extractor's guess. And the reason is that by the hiding of the SF encryption, very roughly. And that's it, okay. Thank you for listening.
Okay, thank you very much. Any questions? More questions?
So a question. So if you think of it, forget for a second about, if you can, about the fact that it's quantum, and think of it as a classical zero knowledge, classical non-black box simulation. Do we get anything interesting here on top of what we know how to do non-black box classically?
Actually,
parameters, communication, whatever. Because it seems like a great general paradigm for doing non-black box simulation, even if you forget about quantum, right?
Yes. So I cannot say if I find one thing interesting. I cannot say if it's interesting for everyone. But one thing I find interesting is that in this part, actually. So if for the part of the audience that remember the most basic kind of simulation strategy of the GMW protocol, this really very reminds of it. Let me just remind you, the simulator is going to guess what challenge the verifier is going to send. And then it knows how to simulate in every case. And here, this is kind of the same. The simulator guesses, we think of the challenge as whether the sender is going to abort or not abort. And we know to simulate when it aborts, and we know to simulate when it does not abort. And this yields a simulator with one special property, that this simulator is successful with the probability, with some noticeable and fixed probability that is independent of the verifier. And then you can also use quantum rewinding on it and do amplification and other sorts of stuff. But it reminds of the most basic simulator.
And can you do a parallel composition here?
I actually didn't think about it. That's obviously.
I don't know. Just maybe you can get constant, a different paradigm to get constant round, zero knowledge in black box. No, it's not going to be public coin, but yeah.
I'm not sure actually.
Okay. Thanks. Yeah, that's great.
Okay, thanks again.
Thank you.